Respected chairperson and my dear colleague, I think Dr. J.C. Mohan, we are just exchanging the place. I am taking the first session, he will be taking the second session. May I just know how much time we have for this session? Because I missed it out.
It's 25 minutes. 25 Pardon? Minutes.
25 minutes. Okay, thank you. So I think in 25 minutes I can finish 500 slides. Okay, fine. Sorry. So the thing is, Dr. J.C. Mohan is here already. Okay. I think they were searching for you, so they asked me to start early. Anyway, so just I want to ask you, have you visited our new Indian Academy of Echo website? If you have not, please visit this site. It's completely overhauled. This is the first, the first page that you will get. Just scroll down, and once you scroll down, you will have the eye guidelines here. Just click onto the eye guidelines, and you will go onto this page, and you have got a stress echo guidelines from Indian Academy of Echocardiography. They are very exhaustive guidelines, and my friend Dr. Bansal has taken a lot of work to put the whole thing together. And those who want to even start this stress echocardiography, they can go through it. It is almost like a manual more than a guidelines. I'll just show you a very small 40 minutes video how we do the stress echo. This is our stress echo lab. This is for the treadmill stress echo, and this is when we do the dobutamine stress echo. Just see this cutout in the bed. Okay, this is a typical Indian jugad because you don't have those stress echo beds. But this is the way that you can keep the patient exactly onto the left lateral side, go into the mid axilla and get the best kind of images. And I'll just show you a small 40 second video. In stress echo, we just inject the contrast before. Just see that the contrast comes into the LV cavity. And just take the four chamber, two chamber, long axis and two short axis views. Then we make the patient walk on the treadmill. At peak exercise, we remove the BPP apparatus and then we inject the contrast. And once the contrast is injected at peak exercise, we stop it and the patient has to immediately come and lie down on his left side. You always give him practice beforehand. Let him be on the left lateral. You can go into that cutout and get the best kind of images. And if you have a contrast in the LV cavity, actually getting a long axis view is very easy. You don't have to really fumble. Now, let me go through some of the recommendations that stress echo is not only regional wall motion abnormality. You can measure by Simpson pre-exercise and peak exercise volumes and ejection fractions. You can also use the coronary territory to find out which territory is having the asynergy or hypokinesia, akinesia, and find out which is the most dominant lesion. So the thing is, there are certain ways to look at the regional wall. So before we go to the cases, I just want to highlight few very important things. Now look for any change in the LV size or shape at the peak exercise. This is the first thing, whether the LV looks small, triangular, or it has dilated, or there are certain bumps on the LV cavity at end systole. So just look at the overall LV size. Look at the one segment at a time. If you look at one segment at a time, you can appreciate the endocardial excursion and thickening. If you look at the whole LV at one time, you can miss a lot of things. Focus on wall thickening rather than motion, because even an ischemic wall can be get pulled and pushed because of the hyperdynamic walls which are close to it. So focus on the wall thickening, because thickening would only happen when there is no ischemia. Then review only the systole so that instead of the complete cardiac cycle. So what you can do is you can put your, you can reduce that, you have this marker of ECG, you bring it to the end of T wave, and then sometimes you can crawl upon the T wave and go to the first two-thirds of systole also, and you can pick up a lot of asynergy or tardokinesia. Secondly, assess the endocardial excursion and takeoff in the first half of systole. That is very interesting, because many tethering motions or many translational motions happen in the later part of systole. In the first part of the systole, it is only the ischemia that produces the asynergy or delayed takeoff. So you always take the marker to almost two-thirds to one-half of your QRS duration and try to find out the asynergy. Second thing is, in dobutamine stress echo, it is very interesting to see the peak stress and compare with 5 mics rather than at the rest, because at 5 mics the wall motions are slightly perked up, so that is why you can see the ischemia induced regional wall motion abnormality is much better when you take baseline as 5 mics and look at the peak. Secondly, even any subtle impairment of contractility during recovery from peak dobutamine is also abnormal. There should not be, because dobutamine will take some time to wear off from the blood. So even at a very high heart rate, you cannot appreciate the regional wall motion abnormality. Just wait for few minutes after stopping dobutamine infusion, and any impairment even in the recovery is abnormal. Many times you can actually increase that wall motion abnormality by rapidly giving beta blockers, so that the heart rate comes down and you can suddenly appreciate the regional wall motion. Try to correlate with the distribution. That is very important. If you have the regional wall motions which do not conform to a coronary territory, it can be just a cardiomyopathic response. And many times the isolated regional wall motion abnormality at the base of the inferior wall or base of the septum are many times seen, and they are false positives. So disregard only basal inferior wall, only basal septum, and if at all there is a mid inferior wall or mid septum or mid posterior lateral wall, then only you will call it as a right coronary territory ischemia. Then you will give the wall motion scoring. Number one is when it is normal, two when it is hypokinetic, three when it is akinetic, four when it is dyskinetic. And you sum up all those 16 segments, because apex you cannot, except when you are using LVO, otherwise you don't see the apex. So you use 16 segments and give this particular wall motion scoring, and then add it up, and that is your numerator, and divided by 16 segments, and that gives you the wall motion score index. So it tells you severity of ischemia and also extent of ischemia. So that is how is the wall motion scoring index. And now we'll go for the cases. Now this is a 39-year-old gentleman with a monomorphic VT, no acute coronary syndrome. Actually, he is a guy working from Medtronic, and he developed monomorphic VT while standing in the cath lab when the ICD was being done for a patient. Anyway, there is no indication to do a stress echo, but obviously you need a stress test to see whether there is a catecholamine induced VT or not. But side by side VT is the current. So you see that there is these are the rest images, these are the peak images, four chambers, apical long axis view. The first thing you can see that in end systole, the volume is very small and the LV almost becomes triangular. So we'll see the other views, and these are the views here, two chamber, four chamber here, two chamber here, and you can see the reduction in the LV cavity. So in this treadmill stress echo, I think there is no regional wall motion abnormality. I'll not put this question, and this is obviously is angiogram, which is perfectly normal. And then how do we go about the wall motion scoring? This is the four chamber. Each one is nice hyperdynamic. You have given it 1-1 score in four chamber. Then in two chamber, again you are given the score of 1. And in long axis view, again you give this score of 1-1. So now you have got 16 at the numerator by adding all these and divided by the 16 segments. So wall motion score index is 1, which is normal. Now let us go for this, his Simpsons. This is four chamber Simpsons at rest. This is four Simpsons at peak. And what you see is that there is a reduction in the end diastolic volume, end systolic volume, and increment in the EF. Now, this is most important, because when you are doing an upright exercise, even the end diastolic volume will also fall. But there should be at least 5% improvement in the EF. When you are doing a supine exercise, the end diastolic volume doesn't reduce. Now let us go for a case, a 32-year-old male, impaired glucose tolerance, non-smoker, atypical chest pain. So he becomes like an intermediate pretest probability. Just because he is male, he has got atypical chest pain, but he has got an impaired glucose tolerance. Now this is his echo. Now you have to see the echo, and as I told you, how do you go about it? You look at one segment at a time. Now this is at rest, this is at peak. Look at one segment at a time. Don't look at the endocardial excursion only, but look at the systolic thickening. Now this systolic thickening appreciation becomes much easier when you have got a contrast. Why? Because contrast shows you the endocardial margin, and also the contrast goes into the epicardial vessels and into the fat surrounding the heart. So it gives you the epicardial border also. So you can see the myocardium perfectly well, the thick black myocardium perfectly well. So just observe the absence of systolic thickening, and then we'll go ahead and we'll see the other. This is a two chamber view, and this is the apical long axis view. So now you will tell me where is the regional wall motion abnormality. LAD, perfect. So let us look at his angio, and I'm sure the interventional cardiologist will start salivating looking at this angio, and no longer, okay. So anyway, so this is a very garden variety of positive stress echocardiography. But remember, stress echo is not all panacea. You are going to have false positives also here. You are going to have false negatives also, and then you are going to have true positives and true negatives. So let us look at how do you improve the prognostic power where you have got a true positive stress echo like this patient. Now the ways to do that is look at the wall motion score index, and I will show you why. Because it tells you the extent of severity, because you are giving him higher score when there is hypokinesia or akinesia or dyskinesia, and also every segment you are going to calculate. So you are also giving the extent of ischemia. So also it takes into account the resting original wall motion abnormality. And also you have to look at the LV end systolic volume, and I'll go through the cases for each one of them. So let us look at this, our patient, and we'll start giving him the wall motion scoring index. So you get 3 at the apex because they have become completely akinetic, and then you go in a 2-chamber view. You will give at mid and apical anterior wall 3-3 because they are akinetic, and in long axis view again you will give it 3-3-3. So your wall motion total score is 29 divided by 16 segment, it is 1.8. Anything above 1.7 has a very poor prognostic value. We'll go through that. Before that, we'll see another case, a 49-year-old marathon runner, non-diabetic, non-hypertensive, perfectly healthy guy, actually my neighbor. One episode of uneasiness during practice. His tropa is 0.6, but remember, your marathon training also raises your tropa. If you have just come out from a training session, your tropa can be slightly high. And actually our lab is having something like 0.03, so this is more than 10 times higher. His city calcium score was 1000. Okay, this is very interesting because many marathoners show higher calcium scores in their coronaries. And this is his resting ECG, and this is his echo. Okay, just observe, again telling you 4-chamber, 4-chamber, 2-chamber, 2-chamber. Look at the inferior septum here, look at the inferior wall there, look at the anterior wall here. Let us go for the long axis view and short axis view. Now this is the septum, posterior wall, and look at the short axis view here. So thing is, tell me, where was the regional wall motion abnormality? Could you tell me, or you want to see it again? I'll just go back. And here we'll run it. See, a very simple thing. Your whole entire inferior wall and the inferior septum are almost actually becoming slightly dyskinetic. Okay. So let us go ahead and look at the angio, and this is his angio, and he has got a very critical right coronary stenosis, and his left coronary is having a lot of calcium there, but no stenotic lesion. So let us go for a 35-year-old male, chest pain 7 days back. He is non-hypertensive, non-diabetic, he has a normal ECG, but he had a rise in tropa. Now these are very tricky ones, a very little rise in tropa, but perfectly normal resting echo, and they have been referred after 7 days. Now look at his stress echo, and you have to tell me the answer. Again, these are the resting images, these are the peak exercise images. As I told you, look at one segment at a time, look at one segment at a time, and look for the systolic thickening. Okay, again, here is the long axis view, septum here, and the posterior wall here. This is the 4-chamber view, this is the inferior septum, and this is the entire lateral wall. You can see the systolic thickening. Compare the systolic thickening of lateral wall with the septum, so also of the posterior wall with the septum. And so let us go ahead, and this is a short axis view, this short axis view, and now you have to tell me what is the regional wall. So where did you get the regional wall? Exactly, it's the posterior lateral, so it has to be circumflex. So let us look at his angio, and actually he has got a completely occluded circumflex vessel without any ECG changes. And why that is so? Because he has got a beautiful collaterals coming from the right coronary artery, and that is why probably he was pain free and there was hardly any regional wall motion abnormality at rest. However, you can see that there was some disease in the diagonal also. If you look at this, you can look at the now each image again. So this is the lateral wall, we'll give it number 3, and then we go for a two chamber view, and now you will realize that actually the mid anterior wall, there is hardly any thickening, while the apical anterior wall is thickening very well. So that was probably related to the diagonal, and so you have got the you give two to this, and then you go ahead in a long axis view, the posterior wall will get 3. You have got a wall motion score of 1.75. now the earlier studies from Mayo group has shown that as the wall motion score index goes on increasing, actually the event rates also go on increasing, and these event rates do not include revascularization, because the clinician can get biased by looking at these echoes. These are hard endpoints, that is MI and cardiac death. Now the same thing is, this is a more contemporary study from the from New York, Dr. Farooq Chowdhury's group, and what they showed that actually when the wall motion score index was between 1.175 and more than 1.7, clinically in the cardiac event rates kept on increasing over the next 5 years. And what they interestingly showed, though a retrospective study, was that those patients who had a medical management versus revascularization, actually only those patients with wall motion score index above 1.7 got a real benefit in reduction of cardiac events. That means you need more extensive ischemia to get the meaningful reduction in cardiac events by revascularization. Of course, a retrospective study can be challenged. But that means your wall motion score index can really act like your FFR. Okay, it can, if you have got that 0.8 FFR or 0.75 FFR, where you show that in a stable coronary artery disease that below that your cardiac event rates go on increasing, we can say that this is your non-invasive FFR. Now the thing is, let us look at one case. This is a 47-year-old male, chest heaviness in the morning. His old stress test was positive at high workload. A stress ECG was positive some 1 year back. Now his troponin is 0.02, but he definitely told us about the chest heaviness in the morning. So he came for an emergency consultation. So he undergoes a stress echocardiography. 6 hour post stress echo, his TROPA is 0.6. Your stress test itself can also induce myocardial necrosis if there is an ischemia. So anyway, this is his resting ECG, which is unremarkable. This is his resting ECG, and this is his peak exercise ECG, and this is his echo. Now very interesting thing. He has got this 4 chamber, 2 chamber, 4 chamber. Your apex is contracting extremely well, but look at the ballooning of the anterior wall. Look at the ballooning of the anterior wall. There is hardly anything. While if you go to two chamber, this is the lateral wall, because you are in a 4 chamber view. Your lateral wall looks absolutely ballooned, while you go to 2 chamber and you have got a nice hyperdynamic anterior wall. Let us look at the long axis. Again, in the long axis, look at the posterior wall. There's absolutely thinning, and as if it has infarcted. It has thinned and become dyskinetic at peak exercise. So this is something like a lateral wall, a distal lateral wall, and a distal posterior wall. Now, most of these people are either having a ramus or a circumflex. Okay, so let us go for his angio. And interestingly, you can see that the LAD looks normal, the obtuse marginal looks normal, but you go to this and you start seeing a vessel there which is actually showing a very slow flow or a TME1 flow there, and this vessel is actually nothing but in ileocaudal view is coming as a ramus. And if you look at the ileocaudal view, just imagine this is like looking at the LV short axis, because you are looking from the LV apex towards the mitral wall in your ileocaudal view. So what you see here is a short axis view. This is something like the junction between the anterior wall and the RV, and you can see that it is the lateral wall that actually should have been the culprit for the stress echo related regional wall motion abnormality. So though his first TROPA was normal when he came to the hospital, the stress echo picked up before we did his 6 hours TROPA, or probably we might have induced more myocardial necrosis by his stress testing. So this is anyway after the PCI, but anyway, let us go ahead and look at another case. A 63-year-old gentleman, he has dyspnea on exertion class 3 and fatigue, and he has undergone a CABG 12 years back. His recent graft angio showed patent lima to LAD and normal SVG to RCA, because he had only 2 grafts, okay, because his circumflex was all fine. He's ex-smoker. So the moment he was having dyspnea on exertion for class 3, an immediate angio was done, lima to LAD normal, SVG to RCA normal. So he was told that probably your dyspnea is all psychological. So the thing is, we put him on stress echo. This is his resting ECG. This is his peak exercise ECG, which actually shows an ST elevation in Q leads, and there is a reciprocal ST depression in 1 AVL. And this is his stress echo. By any imagination, this cannot be normal. You can, first thing is that there is a cardiac dilatation. First image is a cardiac dilatation. Entire LAD territory, entire LAD, everything is akinetic at peak exercise with a normal graft angio. And this is his graft, this is his native coronary, and you can see that there is some competitive filling in the LAD with the graft. And this is his the other view of the native vessel, and then we'll go for the SVG to RCA graft, perfectly working fine. And then you look at the Lima graft. Okay, there is one small stiller there, but it is filling perfectly fine. So why is getting a cardiac dilatation? Just look at the pressure in his left subclavian artery, and then you will realize that actually he has got a very developed a very critical stenosis in his left subclavian artery. So he was actually almost getting like a left main disease kind of a thing, because the Lima was distal to critical stenosis. And obviously after doing the, so that is why if you look at this patient's wall motion score index, it was very high. You can look at the wall motion score index 2.3, a very, very geoparadizing wall motion score. Look at his four chamber and two chamber LV Simpsons at peak and at rest. He has got a cardiac dilatation from 130 to 146. End systolic volume has increased and EF has dropped. So this is a patient who actually had a left subclavian stenosis as a cause. Now this, again, this study from the same group, Aruda and all from the Mayo, and what they showed that if you have a decrease in end systolic volume or no change in end systolic volume or increase in end systolic volume after exercise, actually your event-free survival keeps on reducing. So the end systolic volume itself is very important, that if it doesn't show reduction or it shows increase with exercise, that itself tells you there is a global ischemia and your long-term event-free survival is poor. And if you look at the, so let us go for the another study. If you look at the this bar diagram, actually the cardiac death shown by the red, the non-fatal MIs and the late revascularization, all of them increase if the stress echo shows no change in end systolic volume or rather increase in the end systolic volume. So the thing is, let us go for another case, a 58-year-old gentleman, atypical chest pain on exertion. He's a diabetic for 23 years. He's on insulin. Very high probability of coronary disease, non-hypertensive, non-smoker, and this is his echo. Now you are going to tell me, because now by now you are expert, you can see that the LV is dilated, there is akinesia at the apex, akinesia of the septum, and obviously you have to rush him because his wall motion score will be much more than 2, so you obviously say that it has to be a regional wall, and look at his angio, perfectly normal. Okay, so this is the epicardial vessels which are perfectly normal. You cannot see any kind of a disease in this patient, and look at his perfectly clean, not even plaques there. Okay, he's 23 year diabetics, diabetic, and there is absolutely no plaque there, and you look at the right coronary artery, no plaque. So is it a false positive stress echo? I think you have seen that there was a cardiac dilatation, there was akinesia in LAD territory. So we are dealing with this subset where you have got a regional wall motion abnormality, cardiac dilatation at exercise, but you either have no disease on the coronary or you have got a non-obstructive plaques. Remember, these patients also have a event-free survival as bad as patients with a coronary artery disease. So a true positive and a false positive, the false positive shown by the green and the true positive shown by the red, their cumulative event-free survival is the same. So that means it is, though you are calling it false positive, prognostically it is still bad. And the reasons could be a subclinical cardiomyopathy or a presence of endothelial dysfunction, or it may be just a variant of Takotsubo that you are introducing because of your high dobutamine dose or because of your excess catecholamines at peak exercise. So then how do you improve the appreciation of regional? You can stop me anytime, okay, because there will be lots of cases in this. So improving the appreciation of regional wall motion abnormality. This is a full cycle echo, okay? And you can say that there is some akinesia at the LV apex. But just go for a half systole. You can see the ECG here. You are just on the half systole and you can have much larger territory of akinesia. So that is what I am telling. In the first half of systole, there is hardly any tethering motion or the translational motion of the heart. So look at the first half of, and then you will see much larger territory of regional wall motion abnormality. Now this is a 60-year-old male police officer. He was actually one of those anti-terrorist squad police officer, obviously a high stress job. We made him wait for 5 minutes outside the lab, and he took the whole entire hospital on his head. So he's ex-smoker, hypercholesterolemic, high stress job, and he had chest discomfort during his morning exercise. So we put him on a treadmill before he was going to go for to meet some British anti-terrorist squad at the airport. Before that, we put him on treadmill stress echo, and he had got a complete akinesia of the LAD territory. And we told him, okay, you need an immediate angiogram. So he undergoes for an angiogram, non-obstructive disease. Okay. However, there are plaques. There are definitely there are plaques. You can see the calcium also before the contrast comes. Okay, but there is absolutely non-obstructive plaques. So remember, that means a non-obstructive long calcific disease or endothelial dysfunction can be so powerful to produce ischemia to produce a regional wall motion abnormality, because the regional wall motion abnormality comes the last in a ischemic cascade. So that means, though this patient probably doesn't need a revascularization, he still has a very high, his prognosis is as bad as any coronary artery disease patient. Now he's a 57-year-old gentleman, diabetic, hypertensive, dyspnea on exertion. Look at his echo. This is almost like an LAD territory becoming standstill.
He has got some
the previous patient has a left main disease.
Okay, let just me go back. Okay, I mean the one with the...
Yeah, policeman.
Policeman.
Look at the left main.
Yeah, I think there was a diffuse. There was a discussion about
the point, your catheter is 2 millimeter.
Yeah.
Left main is...
this is a 6F catheter. This is a 6F catheter.
So
yeah.
That means there is about 60-75 stenosis left main.
Stenosis possible, yeah. But even in that case, this gentleman, this was thought of, I think even, I mean, the surgeons and everyone saw this angio, but, they refused the revascularization in this patient. Obviously, one should have an IVUS guided area taken at this left main. So let us go for this last, patient.
Let us think whether they want to have some question answer or see more
questions. Yeah, yeah.
Do you have to question answer, want to go
yeah,
to
we
question
have the
or
question
or
answers.
More,
yeah.
More cases. Anirudha, at this juncture, we have got 5 minutes more.
Yeah, you can ask questions, that would be great.
Okay.
Case, Dr. Mohan, you can see here, is the same, the one I showed you with the LAD territory akinesia. As you saw it, there is a very distinct, rounding of the apex and everything. And if you look at his angio, there is only an haziness in the ostial LAD. But actually, if you take all other views, the lumen diameter part looks perfectly fine. Okay, and interestingly, this was FFR negative also. But I'm sure that there is an active lesion there at the ostial LAD. Only thing probably you can get away with antiplatelets and statins, but that means it came up on exercise. Probably then there was the endothelial dysfunction may have produced an ostial LAD spasm also during exercise, may be the reason. But anyway, I was just trying to show you different facets of stress echocardiography, and I think you can ask any question. And anyone of you want to start stress echocardiography, just go through that manual and you will be a pro, you will start using it. And there are lots of videos with those. They are all there on the net, on the IE website, and you can do your self-learning also.
So I think Dr. Barkule has shown a large spectrum of disease, CAD, and correlation of the echo. And he has highlighted certain issues, looking into thickening, scoring, size, particularly end systolic volume, and correlation with the outcome also. So if you have any question technical, because he is always doing hands-on on these issues, you can ask, or if you would like to have some comment, Dr. Joshi Mohan can put some comment also. You are open for 5 minutes. Dr. Mitra, would you like to comment anything?
Yeah, Dr. Burkule. I want some special comment from you on two areas. One is what is the current role of stress echo in the management or evaluation of acute coronary syndrome, patient presenting with acute, whether we should put stress on stress echo or we go for some, in other words, how stress echo will help in the future guidelines in the management of acute coronary, number one. Number two, how the stress echo does it gives any information relating to predictors in the management of heart failure, that is with special reference to device therapy, with a responder or non-responder, CRTs, whether these two situations, how the stress echo is going to help our practitioners?
Yeah, These are two very practical questions. First, I will take about the ACS and then for the heart failure. Now, the there are appropriate stress echo usefulness guidelines already there about the appropriate use of stress echo, especially in the ACS group. Now, you have lots of patients with chest pain and who are TROP negatives, and the ECG is non-diagnostic. I think this is the best group to do the stress echo cardiography before discharge. Okay, because the sensitivity of stress echo will be around 85% to 88%, because your stress ECG is going to have sensitivity specificity in the range of 60% to 77%. So it's going to be better if you do a stress echocardiography in this group who are TROP negatives, but the pain is atypical in presence of lot of comorbidities, or it looks typical but the TROPA is negative, ECG is perfectly normal, then there is an appropriate use here for a rapid discharge. When there is a troponin is definitely high above in the 95th percentile, and also there is a rise of more than 20 nanogram per liter, then probably you don't need it because that gives you a diagnosis of ACS. But of course, if you have a suspicion that this is a non-coronary rise of troponin, again the stress echo comes handy because there are a lot of non-ischemic rise of troponin. Then comes the question of the heart failure. Now it is very interesting, as I showed you that cases where you get a cardiac dilatation on stress echo while your coronaries are normal. Now there are studies which have shown that actually these are the patients who later on present with either HFpEF, that is heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, or they present with late onset atrial fibrillation or higher incidence of atrial fibrillation. So that means you are unmasking some amount of LV dysfunction, and that was probably over the period manifest as either an HFpEF or presents as atrial fibrillation. Probably it's the same continuation of the disease or lifestyle disease. So that is one thing. Secondly, about CRT. When you exercise the patient, so actually treadmill is not done for the CRT evaluations because those patients are generally sick, so you will be doing dobutamine. When you give dobutamine, actually the dyssynchrony goes on increasing and the EF starts dropping and the stroke volume starts dropping, and they are actually the better responders. Now there are a lot of single center studies from Europe which showed that on dobutamine, if you show an increasing dyssynchrony between septum and lateral wall, and if there is a fall in stroke volume, they have got an excess of 90% chance of being a CRT responder. But again, small center studies. So that is the only use in the CRT subgroup.
Until now, we have to depend on the dyssynergy and other things. So,
pardon?
Okay.
Nitin, I would like to know. See, you had shown few cases where the coronaries were normal. The one which you showed of the policeman, I also agree with Dr. Mohan that he has got left main and also an OM lesion. Quickly, I could see there are definitely lesions. But the ones which you showed, few of those. Angiograms, the epicardial coronary arteries were normal.
Correct.
Then, did you correlate these patients with further investigations like stress system maybe or with cardiac MRI so that any other problem can be delineated? Did you do a, it is better to coordinate with system maybe so that you know whether there is a real ischemia or not, that's first thing. Second, by doing a cardiac MRI, you can find out whether there is any other reason for this type of an abnormality like a previous myocarditis or something like that. Unless you do all those investigations, I think it is inadequate for us to draw conclusions.
Yeah, this is a valid point, of which the system maybe I will not be very convinced, because many of these patients like diabetic cardiomyopathy, like that guy was 23 years of diabetes and perfectly clean vessels, and he had gotten cardiac ballooning. So this is supposed to be a microangiopathy or a diabetic cardiomyopathy which we are unmasked on the stress test. So the ischemic component may not be there. It is the actual dysfunction of the myocytes and the laying down of collagen in the interstitium. So probably systemic is not useful, but MRI I'm sure, because MRI will show probably some late guideline enhancement. And another thing is that small subendocardial infarcts in the past, the late guideline MRI will definitely pick up, which is you know, and that's why these patients are showing that dysfunction of those segments at peak exercise. So it is one of the valid point. But remember, having a dysfunction on stress echocardiography has got a very high mortality and higher chances of going to heart failure, higher chances of developing atrial fibrillation, and your event-free survival is very poor. So that means just having normal coronary doesn't mean anything.
Varunangshu, please.
We have to close the session here because okay. we have overshot by two.
Thank you very much, Dr. Barkule, for the nice covering.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Barkule, for your words of wisdom. I'm sure all of us would like to have many questions to ask. I would like to request all of you to please contact him in person, because we are stick with the time and we have lot more new things coming up which are very exciting.